Well, hello, good afternoon, good evening, good morning, wherever you are. Today, we have the pleasure of interviewing Joel Felsenstein in the fourth of the series, but also, you know, finding out about his fight for the right to party. And today's topic is all about why it's not an illness, that why autism is not an illness that needs to be cured. I think it's going to be quite an interesting discussion, because there are a lot of misconceptions out there about what autism is or isn't. So I'm looking forward to having an interesting discussion with you today, Joel. Welcome, as always. How are things with you today?
I'm fantastic as always, Mac. Been up for the past 6 hours so far. I have slept, and I'm ready to go.
Awesome stuff. That is great to hear. We've already got a few people jumping on. We've just had Ilya talking about a great conversation, and thanks for enabling this topic. The reality is I'm facilitating, but you're the man that's the vision behind the enabling right now, because Life Hacks with Mac is just here to do the interview, but ultimately RockstarX is the vision. So we're going to get more into that in a second, but do us a favor, tell us today a little bit, for those who haven't heard your background, could you give us a little insight into, the journey that you've had, how they found out that you have autism, how that's impacted you, just a little bit of a flavor of a background before we get into the main topic of, autism is not an illness that needs to be cured.
Yeah, sure, Mac. I was diagnosed back when I was 9. By that time, I was 4 years into my musical journey. And considerably longer in annoying my neighbors and parents by bashing around the table. I was diagnosed at the age of 9. I then moved. I started off in one school. We thought the education would be peachy. Started off in one school, proceeded to the next one. And over the course of my entire career, I wanted to be even across all educational platforms. So I went to 2 elementary and then 2 high schools to even the playing field.
Carry on. I've got some questions around that one.
Each was as interesting as the next, shall we say.
And it's interesting because I know you shared an article with me recently, in fact, several articles, about the challenge parents of autistic children have with regards to just getting their children to be able to be accepted and be in a position where there's consistency in their life. Consistency is such an important element for people with autism, as I have experienced with my brother, is, just knowing what the next day looks like and having clear, guidelines. That must have been quite unsettling to be able, to get it, into one school and then all of a sudden have to be dragged out and moved to another one and then have to, face new people, new teachers. That must have been a nightmare just for yourself. I mean, with four schools in itself. But, some of these articles that you shared with me, there are some people that have been in anywhere between 10 and 20 schools in their school kind of process, and that's frightening. So, what do you put that down to? What was the reason that you ended up having to move so much?
The education system is certainly in the UK. I'm not sure about any other country, but certainly in the UK, the education system is very, very ironically uneducated when it comes to neurodiverse. And it shows when you have a mainstream set up in a school and then you plonk a unit in there and then your classes are in the mainstream part of the school with 30 other people in the class as well. And some people are fine with it, but you'll find that most people on the spectrum would find that a humongous sensory issue. And as a result, will come out of school learning more nothing than they went in with.
So, you know, you've dropped a few words in there, like sensory overload, and it reminds me of that quote where, you know, if you ask a goldfish to climb a tree, you know, it's not going to be that successful. And this is where the systems, as it were, not only locally but internationally, have always been a challenge, because it's trying to take the few and make them conform with the many, which means support structures haven't always been there. In most structures, in most situations, are still not available. And you know, how did you survive that challenge through school? Because that's extremely demotivating, should we say, to an individual who is forced to fit in, as opposed to flourish and be supported in the way you should be.
Well, it was hard. My first secondary school, or high school in America, that I went to, I went there because everyone from my elementary school went there. So it made sense, because mum thought, okay, he's made friends. Trouble is, when you get to high school, your friends form groups, and therefore you're the last person to be picked, kind of like when you're in gym, and you're just standing there waiting to be picked for a team, and it never comes, and then you're paired with the teacher. And then I didn't last long at that school. In fact, I hardly went in yet. For some bizarre reason, even though I wasn't there in person, I achieved perfect attendance.
And was that mostly the system just trying to make the time pass by, as it were, to show that you've gone through, rather than support?
Yes, it was, but by the time I was 13, it sort of, we knew that school was utterly hopeless, and we were trying to get into the private school, in which is the old Orange Hill School in the UK, in Burnt Oak, which had a unit and was set up more or less better than the previous school. It was certainly a smaller school, but by year 12, I had done my GCSEs. I didn't revise, and somehow I managed to get 3 anyway. And by year 12, I said, you know what? I've had enough. What am I going to gain by staying an extra year? I'm not even going to do A-levels. We both know that. My grades were too low. I didn't even do enough GCSEs to warrant me to do A-level, so what the hell am I still doing here? So I dropped out.
Now, I know from some of the previous interviews we've done, you know, the crazy challenges you have faced, both with health and, you know, discrimination, as it were, being treated differently. And that's why I'm really interested in this topic of trying to enlighten people about, you know, what autism is all about. Because it, you know, a lot of people don't understand it. I find that speaking to some people, they have absolutely no clue. And they, you know, some people think it's an illness, as you rightfully said. And that there's some magic pill or there's a treatment that you can go on to fix you. And it's interesting because this applies to globally. You know, autism is just an example today that we're using. But, you know, you look at it's almost applicable across things like religion, race, sex, all those things where people go, you're different to me. We need to fix you. And they want to, because it's something that's misunderstood or not understood or not given the time of day, to find out more and to educate and enlighten. So talk to me. I mean, let me ask you that question. You know, why is it not an illness that needs to be cured?
It's individual. It's like me saying, I want a computer that does this, this, and this, and the shop saying to me, here is a computer, this is the one for you. And I'm like, no, it's not. This is not what I wanted to do. It's doing average stuff. I wanted a computer that would do high-end graphics and stuff, and you've given me this, something else. It's not the same thing. Same with autism. I said this in one of my other, I believe, interviews, Matt, with you. And I pulled the Sony, Samsung, Apple, and Microsoft analogy.
Would you mind sharing that with us again?
Yes. So the Microsoft, Samsung, Apple, for wanting a better word, triangle. Love-hate triangle, because they do love and they hate each other as well. On the outside, they look the same. They do the same thing, debating whether or not they each have better functions, but
that's a whole different discussion.
That's a whole different discussion, but that is also relevant to autistic people as to if we have, or some people on the autistic spectrum have better knowledge of stuff than others, and someone can hyperfocus, that's not to do with the outside, yes. That's to do with our insides and how we're programmed. It's exactly the same situation if you pair Apple, Linux, Microsoft, Sony, Samsung, and the different chains of Linux, Ubuntu, Kali,
you've already gone over my head.
They all do the same things. Some have extra features than the others that are largely unnecessary. But though that which is necessary for those, that they are specifically made and designed in a way that capitalizes on their strengths and what they are built for. Are you telling me that we can't do that with a human being? Play to the strengths.
Yeah, it's I think people need to digest that for a second.
It's like Steve Hughes' Live at the Apollo when he did that sketch on the War on Terror. And he said, "What does war create?"
I haven't seen it.
What does war create? Terror. So your fight, your actions are fighting the consequences which you're trying to prevent.
And it's like that whole fire with fire
yes
concept.
Yes.
So, you know, carry on about the, you know, why it's not an illness that needs to be cured, because I'd like to hear more about that, especially for those people who don't really understand what autism is.
Well, we've got these experts who claim they understand the term autism and what it is. You can't fully understand autism unless you've got it. And it's also very individual to the person who's got it. Kind of like when you want to get a bespoke suit made. It certainly isn't one size fits all. Otherwise, we'd be looking very odd indeed, walking around over oversized suits and or the other way around. But
that could be painful.
Yes, exactly. So it's not a one size fits all, and this is why the system is failing, because it's trying to do something with one model. And the reality is that autistic people are not one model, and it's not a psychiatric illness. It's not a disease, and you won't catch it if you go near rats, you catch rabies. It's not like that at all. It's not cancerous. It's just a different way of thinking.
Yeah. And it's interesting because, you know, when you speak to different people, and you know, unfortunately, just because you've dealt with autism with one person doesn't mean that it's the same for the next person that you deal with. You know, there are some traits, but the majority, you know, and this is where, you know, terms have changed so much over the last 10, 15, 20 years even, that... just, you know, anybody, because I saw a gentleman that I know quite well, and he's quite an avid LinkedIn poster with a lot of strong opinions, Richard Sumner. He did a quadrant and explained, you know, where people fall on the quadrant when it comes to the spectrum, and how you could be, you know, in what is known by a lot of people as high functioning, you know, part of the quadrant, and then you can have somebody else who is considered low functioning, but the assessment is the same for both, and they're treated the same because they have autism. Yet, you know, we see so many people that are treated, and I've seen a lot of this in the special needs circles, where people are assumed based on the, it's like that saying that says never judge a book by its cover. And with autism, I think that is just so spot on, because I've met people that are, from the outside, you know, no eye contact, won't speak, and the normal human being, and I put that in inverted commas because there's no such thing, but would assume that person, you can't communicate, or that person is any less talented. Yet we find these amazing geniuses in these people that they just express themselves differently. And as you keep saying, they just wired differently. So instead of going, this is strange, I don't know how to communicate. And it's a similar, you know, when you meet somebody who speaks a different language, we find ways to communicate. and, you know, through your vision of working with people with music, that universal language, it's so powerful. So talk to me about, you've mentioned this before, and people tend to be scared to approach different, and you must have faced a lot of that where people, they're not quite sure how to communicate with you, or they're just afraid to say the wrong thing, because that's, you know, a big challenge for a lot of people. What do you suggest? You know, how do, like, if somebody wants to go and learn more without offending anybody, what is the best way to go about, you know, reaching out to somebody with autism and communicating with them? What is your opinion?
Well, the internet is a very wonderful invention. So I would say talk to us online. Is the safest option, because if you came across a non-speaking autist, doesn't mean they can't type. It does not mean they can't type. And if you want to also, you can communicate through music as well. I know several people who are non-verbals and verbals who are on the spectrum, but this spectrum is so big, it's now borderline ridiculous, and it's now you're grouping things that are completely irrelevant to the autistic side with autism. So anything you don't understand ends up on the spectrum, which is another name for I don't understand this, therefore I'm sticking it into the in-tray, which is full of mystery.
I love that. And it's so true, because it's like, if we look at what the spectrum was maybe 5-10 years ago, and then you look at it today, is like, it's just mad what has been bundled in there. It's just like, hey, I don't understand. Let's throw them in that category. And that must be really frustrating.
It is. It is. It's the only hope I can have for the world is that they don't take as long as they did with the LGBTQ communities to realize that autistic people are not weird.
I've got to throw in a comment here, because we've had a couple of comments. So I'm going to go to the first one, which is by Amanda. Neurotypicals aren't used to people thinking and processing things differently than they do. Autistics realize this is an everyday reality. And I mean, what are your thoughts there, Joel?
Well, that's what Amanda has said there is the very reason why you would find many people on the autistic spectrum mask their ability. And I hate the word ability. I hate the word ableism. But in reality, that is the truth of a fair number of them on the spectrum. We want to get a job.
And that leads me nicely into this next one. The person is anonymous, and they, you know, happily put your name in the comments if you want to share, just based on their LinkedIn settings. They don't allow their details to come across to second and third party connections. So this one is interesting, because as they say, you know, you don't look autistic. a comment they get on a daily basis. People with autism act, speak, and react differently. Yes. No two people are the same. Some have underlying aspects, conditions that can be hidden well, masking, as you put, whereas others show their signs a lot clearer. And I mean, that's such a good way, you know, just the way that that's been put in, I've just created a new word, put is phenomenal. You know, it's so clear. And that one part that people forget is the other underlying things that contribute. So, you know, I look at my brother-in-law, who's an incredible human being. Yes, he's on the spectrum, but he also has something called Fragile X, which is fairly rare. And that displays itself in a certain way. Now, if anybody met him and they were told, oh, he's autistic, without talking about any of the other things that he faces, then they would assume everybody would have the same traits for autism. But it's got nothing to do with autism. It's got to do with his Fragile X. But he also has autism. And this is where it's so easy to miss understand, you know, autism, as it were. Because that's like seeing somebody who is, I mean, this is bizarre, but like somebody who is, say, a guitarist, and you look at their features and you go, ah, okay, they've got a long rock star hairstyle, you know, similar to Joel. And you know, they have a certain look, and then all of a sudden everybody in the street, yeah, that's a guitarist. And in the meantime, they might be totally tone deaf and not have any chance of playing an instrument. But you're assuming based on information that isn't correct. You know, what are your thoughts on that before we go on to the next one?
Assumption is very easy. Sadly,
I thought you were going to give us a quote there, and I was a bit worried about the language. But carry
assumption
on.
Is very easy. Sadly, and I would say that it's the lazy person's way of building up a character. I don't want to get to know this person, but at the same time, he's interesting, so he must be this. But the downside with all that is that if they aren't that, you're disappointed. So you've effectively expected something and it's not turned out to be true. You're either disappointed or you're surprised. And we humans do have a tendency to judge easy.
Way too easily. You know, I'm blown away with every time we speak. You know, I learn a little bit more, not necessarily about autism, but about being human. When I speak to you, Joel, because you, yeah, somebody's just mentioned the blue beard. I'll refer to that later, because that might could be confusing quite a few people today, thinking, what the hell's happened to Mac? You know, your ability to, and this is one thing that, you know, I implore everybody watching this to connect with Joel. And, you know, if you get 5 minutes with a guy, that'll be a blessing in itself, because firstly, always, you know, positive, one hell of a sense of humor. You know, he plays the drums, he plays the guitar, he happens to be sponsored by some of the biggest names out there, so he kind of knows what he's doing. But your vision to, and there needs to be another word for it, rather than enable, but to make a difference and help, you know, people really accept the others' individualness, you know, our uniqueness is so important. And you know, I know when we talk about RockstarX, which is the brand for you, Joel, You talk about, the neurodiverse, but it's so much bigger than just that title. You know, it's about, there's a saying that says a lack of knowledge is a lack of interest. And really that's what it comes down to. When we don't know and we don't understand, a lot of the time we'll just brush things off, because that makes us feel easy, more comfortable, or it serves our own purposes rather than trying to understand that other human being. I want to have a quick look at some of the other comments that we have over here. Let's share. I'm just going to grab a few because we've got so many coming through. So from Lee, diagnosis, labels, none of that matters. We all have value and we all have something to contribute. Joel, we are all weird. I love that. And I guess, Bluebeard, no more to be said. Thank you both for sharing your thoughts and experiences. Lee, thank you for taking the time to comment and engage. Really do appreciate it. And you're 100% correct. I only like connecting with weird people anyway, so it's all good. If you're normal, that normally sets off alarm bells for me. Joel, I'm conscious of time.
You're always conscious of time. You're like my dad.
I am. Well, the thing is, we have other people's time to respect, and we are going to be having more of these discussions. I keep saying we have a little mini series of 8 episodes, but as you keep telling me, Mac, that's just the that's what's planned, but it's not what's going to happen.
We know that. Everyone in the audience knows that.
Well, we started off with having a life hacks with Mac and just saying, hey, we're going to do a one-off interview just to introduce you and your story. And we've done more lives as a result.
Yes, the lesson here, ladies and gentlemen, is never set yourself limits.
Thanks, Joel. 100%. That's still something, I'm at my tender age of, and I won't give my age away because the beard 48. Is pretty clear. Nope. But close. Damn. is still something that I'm learning is, we're always learning. There's always something new, and setting limitations on ourselves is purely just a decision or a feeling that we put on ourselves, which is not reality. And when you don't put those limitations on yourself, it's incredible what happens, and the people that you meet. So, and I say that to people watching this, if you've met somebody in the audience and they're commenting, whether it be on Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, just connect with those people, start a conversation, because you just never know where it's going to lead. I mean, this is how you and I got introduced, is via LinkedIn, with somebody saying, hey, can you help Mac? Or Mac, can you help Joel? Sorry, I do need help myself, but that's a different story. it's amazing where that's led, and I'm loving the journey. So limitations removed, and let's see where this may lead. What else would you like to share with the audience right now, from your experience, Joel, with regards to this topic?
My experience with this topic, one of the comments that you brought up from the anonymous user, I had a friend say that exact line in that exact way to me a few weeks ago, saying, "You don't look autistic. You don't sound autistic.
You definitely sound artistic."
Yes. I'm sorry. What are we meant to sound like or look like? Last time I checked, it was a different way of thinking, not an entire human race.
It's amazing how we like to put people into like cookie cutter samples of going, I can identify this. I'm good. Look at me. and then when you don't fit, it's okay. I'm not sure which tray to put this person in. You know, it's like,
if you put people in the box too much, you're no longer watching. You're no longer living in the real world, people. You're watching television.
And this is where, too much potential sci-fi kicks in. you're supposed to have like a third arm or something weird going on just to help. It's like an identifier. It's anyway, that's a whole other conversation.
I mean, with Huey Lewis's song "Hip to Be Square," I cannot disagree with that statement more.
Absolutely, and you know, on that topic, Joel. Afterwards, I'm going to ask you to do exactly what we've done previously. Is Joel on a road trip back from looking at an incredible venue that would be amazing for RockstarX, he came up, well, we were discussing a empowering playlist, not only for people with autism, but just a playlist that basically embodies the you know, those power ballads that really speak to uniqueness, to our individuality. And originally I think we had about 10-15 songs on there. Now it's like
over 200
out of my mind. Over 200. Oh man. And I tell you what, I'm yet to find somebody that I say, hey, do us a favor, switch that playlist on, where they don't just get sucked in and it makes their day. Because it's so many incredible power ballads. And if you've got suggestions, you know, that you think, you know, this is my power ballad that really makes me come out and feel in control, then, you know, feel free to go and share those in the comments, because Joel and I will, well, Joel will vet them and then throw them on the list. But Joel, if you can, after this, share on LinkedIn for those of you who are watching on either Facebook or YouTube. LinkedIn is the place to go and follow Joel, because this is where he is rocking the world. So I would suggest connecting with him there if you haven't already, and follow the RockstarX journey. If you go and look at the description of this event, you'll see the link to the RockstarX page. Please go and follow that, which is where Joel and the team will be, you know, putting regular updates out there as to what's happening, what we're looking for, who we're looking to connect with. Joel, any final thoughts as we wrap up the last minute and 10 seconds?
We've also launched a YouTube channel as well. Currently, he's got nothing on it at the moment.
We'll be sharing the link to that as well.
Not a great selling point, but we've currently got a generic URL, which Google has blessed us with. So we would love to be able to change that as soon as possible.
So that's definitely something to share on the RockstarX page, because once you get to 100 subscribers, you can go and change the URL. So that'll be cool. Anything else, Joel?
When you said Joe and the team, you're part of the team. So Mac is part of the team. At one of his many hats. I'm surprised he hasn't managed to lose any of them yet. He's part of the team. So he will be also posting.
Awesome stuff. I'm just having a look through some of the comments over here. Hey, Lisa, so good to see you. It's been ages. Lisa's just reached out saying she'll connect you with her autism specialism contacts too. That'll be amazing. We're looking at different ways to support and help people with autism get access to things like better jobs, you know, access to music, access to be able to, you know, work in the gaming industry, all of those things, anything that will help empower, you know, people with autism or neurodiverse people as a whole, you know, that's what we're looking for. So we're looking at putting retreats together to go and help individuals gain access to music, to learn music, also as music therapy. So any of those things that you can think of, please, you know, drop those contacts in. Anybody that has experience, either being, if you, you know, that would be incredible, because we've got so many incredible human beings with autism, but also people that have worked with or work with organizations that empower autistic and neurodiverse people, that would be incredible. So Joel, thank you for the incredible human that you are and the vision that you have. And I'm excited to see what the world has in store, you know, 5-10 years from now, because I think, you know, there've been a lot of organizations out there that facilitate, but I truly believe RockstarX is going to be a place that will empower. And that's what I'm really excited about, is celebrating our uniqueness. Thank you so much for sharing today, being so open and approachable and honest with some of your, you know, if you go and watch some of the previous interviews, Joel doesn't beat around the bush. And that's what I love about it, is no BS. It's just like straight in. Sometimes I have to worry about potential language overrides, but it's all good. It's, you know, at the end of the day, it is what it is. It's I don't think anybody's going to, have an issue with that, but you know, Joel, just keep being you. That's what we need, more of you in the world. So thank you so much for taking the time and keep reminding me that you know, not having or setting ourselves limits is such an important mindset to have. So everybody, if you've been watching this, Joel will be having another one of these sessions. There are many other conversations to be had. This is just the beginning, but this is a part of a 8-part mini series, and our next one is going to be quite an interesting one, because, well, they're all interesting, but it's going to be, you know, neurodiversity in the world. So watch the space. Joel and I will be sharing the link to that, and you'll be able to see that through our events, and I look forward to having more of these conversations with you, Joel. Thank you very much for your time today.
You're welcome. And I believe that that event is happening on the last day of June.
So keep those eyes peeled, people. You know, if you want to find out why the blue beard, just go to my profile. I did a LinkedIn live yesterday, which Joel helped around in the background, but I clearly babbled a little bit. But that's part of my wonderful long COVID and fuzzy brain. So I just push on through. Because life's too short to sit back and wait for perfection. So thank you, everybody, for watching. And I wish you all an incredible, incredible week ahead. Make the best of it. Seize every day and live every day, too. So as my motto always goes, you never know where a conversation may lead you. So please go and have many. Joel, thank you very much. Would you mind playing us your little sting outro?
Not at all, my pleasure.
Excellent stuff, good man.
Enjoy.